I'd like to introduce this session with some brief reflections on the psychology of worldviews from a certain more general point of view. As you all know, Jaspers has published his Psychology of Worldviews in 1919, 6 years after the publication of the first edition of General Psychopathology in 1913. In the years following 1919, only slightly revised new editions of the General Psychopathology and the Psychology of Worldviews were published. Additionally, in 1922, the short study on Strindberg and Van Gogh. Until the end of 1921, some book reviews, and in 23, the first very brief presentation of Jaspers' idea of the university. Then Jaspers did not publish anything until 1931. Even if this publication activity would be quite considerable for normal mortals, for Carl Jaspers, it means an unusual long, unusual silent phase. In particular, in the years between 1919 and 1931, as few new works have been published by Jaspers as in the years of the Third Reich. We all know that in the years after the appearance of the Psychology of Worldviews, Jaspers did his education in philosophy, or as he himself once put it, he started studying philosophy at a time where he was already professor for philosophy. In the 12 years after the publication of the Psychology of Worldviews, Jaspers developed his philosophy of existence, which he then published in the early 1930s with the title Philosophy. So Jaspers was not inactive in the 1920s, but reoriented himself scientifically and academically. So it is, in my humble opinion, very appropriate to call the Psychology of Worldviews a book in transition, namely the transition from Jaspers, the physician and psychiatrist, to Jaspers, the philosopher. As a physician and psychiatrist, Jaspers was initially primarily interested in the pathology of human mental life. Jaspers wrote his dissertation and his first scientific work at the beginning of the 20th century, not the 1920s. This is at a time where psychology was establishing itself as an independent experimental empirical science. Also, the dispute about psychologism, which was actively waged from the middle of the 19th century to the beginning of the 20th century, was not totally settled in this time. Still, it was not clear whether the psychologistic position would prevail. If it would, it could have meant the end of philosophy as the primary methodological science. Jaspers did not take an active part in this debate, especially since he did not even define himself a philosopher at the beginning of the 20th century, but he observed this debate with great interest. In particular, he was interested in the methodological quality of psychopathology. His general psychopathology represents the attempt to establish psychopathology as a systematic science. As Jaspers points out in the introduction to the general psychopathology from 1913, from his point of view, it's important to learn, I quote, to think psychopathology, quote end, and not to learn just psychopathology as a bunch of facts. Considering this, it is no surprise that after 1913, Jaspers started to work on a comprehensive book about interpretative psychology, or Verstehende Psychologie is its German term, a term that he introduced in his general psychopathology. As part of this work, Jaspers also deals with the topic of worldviews, which was very popular at the beginning of the 20th century. Jaspers himself gave lectures on this topic in the late 20s of the 20th century. But the project of a book on interpretative psychology was dropped by him in 1916-17. Instead, Jaspers focused his research on the topic of worldviews. This turns out to be a good choice when in 1919, a position as an associate professor for philosophy was vacant at Heidelberg University, Jaspers, who until then only held a venia legendi for classes dealing with psychology, applied for this professorship. And he applied for this with the Psychology of Worldviews. And in spring of 1920, he was appointed associate professor for philosophy in Heidelberg. So personally for Jaspers, the Psychology of Worldviews was a ticket to an academic career as a philosopher. The eminently philosophical impact of this book, however, is not due to the strategic considerations. In the foreword of the fourth edition of the Psychology of Worldviews, which Jaspers wrote in 1954 in Basel, he retrospectively comments on the hybrid nature of the psychology of worldviews, which he calls in 1954 his, I quote, first philosophical utterance, quote end. At the time of writing The Psychology of Worldviews, it was important for Jaspers to deal with the problem of worldviews in a way that was clearly distinguished from what he has called prophetic philosophy. He argues against prophetic philosophy because from his point of view, the normative intentions of such a philosophy is against the very nature of true philosophy, which should enable self-reflection and help to live an autonomous life. So Jaspers' goal was, consistently with the idea of his interpretative psychology, to only provide, I quote, clarifications and possibilities as a means of self-reflection, quote end. He also points out in the foreword for this first edition of Psychology of Worldviews, I quote again, anyone who wants a direct answer to the question of how he should live his life will look in vain for it in this book, quote end. The philosophical impetus in the Psychology of Worldviews thus consists in a program that Jaspers develops in his period of silence in the 20s, which was later published as Philosophical World Orientation and Enlightenment of Existence, so namely in its great work, Philosophy. It is well known that one very important part of the Enlightenment of Existence, the analysis of limit situations, was first released in the Psychology of Worldviews. As Jaspers wrote about his early work in 1954, all of this happens with philosophical naivety and, this is a term from Jaspers, fruitful obscurity. Some thoughts, which Jaspers later put forward with great philosophical detail, have already been presented in perhaps not crystal clear, but fresh and colorful way in the Psychology of Worldviews, which, by the way, was Jaspers' first book written not only for a scientific audience, but for everyone with a certain degree of general education. So nearly right from the beginning of his philosophical career, Jaspers' intent was to reach out beyond the limit audience of the scientific community. In the new edition of the Psychology of Worldviews, published in 2019 by Oliver Immel, as part of the complete edition of Jaspers' writings, this new edition is preceded by a very informative introduction from the editor and provides extensive comments and annotations, which give a good insight into the historical and philosophical significance of this work of transition. The fact that this work is now at the center of this conference can, from my point of view, be considered as a lucky chance for the research on Jaspers. And again, I like to express my heartfelt thanks to everyone who contributes to this conference today in these difficult times, which have been realized also here in this quite unusual setting in the Zoom conference. So having that said this, I'd like to introduce our first speaker in this evening, which happens to be Chabai Olai. He has studied philosophy, mathematics, and physics at Eötvös Loránd University in Budapest in Hungary. Before he continued his studies, focusing now completely on philosophy, at Albert Ludwigs University in Freiburg, Germany. He obtained his PhD from the Freiburg University in 2005. Mr. Olai has been teaching philosophy at Eötvös Loránd University since 2001. He was appointed there full professor in 2015 and is currently head of the Department of Modern and Contemporary Philosophy at this university in Budapest. He is recognized as academic teacher and speaker all over Europe and has taught classes and delivered lectures from multiple institutions, e.g. the Humboldt University in Berlin, International Center for Philosophy in North Rhine-Westphalia in Bonn, the University de Bourgogne in Dijon, France, for just to mention a few of these different locations. So if the circumstances allow it, he is traveling quite a lot to deliver his lectures, which qualifies him as a truly international scientist. His main research area in the continental philosophy of the is the continental philosophy of the 19th and 20th century, especially the hermeneutic philosophy and authors like Martin Heidegger, Hans-Georg Gadamer, Hannah Arendt, and also the Frankfurt School. Regarding our subject today, there is at least one paper to mention, which has been published by Mr. Olai. This is a study about the influence of Wilhelm Dilthey and Max Weber on Karl Jaspers' concept of worldviews, which was published in the collection in 2017 in Italy. I hope that Mr. Olai will bring the most important pieces of this topic and his current view on this to our attention.
In this short presentation, I would like to reflect on Dilthey's role in the augmentation of the psychology of worldviews and also make some comments on his impact, explicit and implicit, upon Jaspers' philosophical project. It will be shown that the concept of worldview is considered in the secondary literature primarily in connection with the concept of shell or objectivized cage, Gehäuse, a concept Jaspers took from Max Weber. I shall defend the claim that this evaluation is one-sided insofar as it underestimates Dilthey's impact on Jaspers. His conception of a psychology of worldviews unites motifs both from Wilhelm Dilthey and Max Weber, constructing thus a Weberized Dilthey or Dilthey and Weber. After some conceptual clarifications, I treat first the specific contribution of Dilthey and Max Weber to Jaspers' theory and discuss the later afterward. Finally, I show that despite its disappearance in the later work, the concept of worldview survives in the requirement of openness, which makes up a basic idea in Jaspers' work. In this sense, worldview remains one of the basic categories of his thought, even if marginalized in his later work. Let us begin with some terminology. Worldview in ordinary usage refers to an overall view of the world, a picture of what there is and what it is like. It should be noted that the second part of the German original, Weltanschauung, so Anschauung, is hard to translate into other languages. In French, we find vision du monde, image du monde as synonyms. In English, worldview and seldom world picture. In philosophy, it is rather a new usage. It occurs in Kant's analysis of the sublime, although not implying the plurality of worldviews. After Fichte and German idealism, the plurality of positions or points of view emerges as a task for philosophy to synthesize. Turning to Jaspers' thought, some prominence is given to the term worldview merely based on the fact that it figures in the title of his first work, that is philosophical in a narrower sense. The term unambiguously refers to philosophical discussions of the fin de siècle and thus formulates a philosophical project, even if the expression psychology covers some undecidedness. It is no doubt that Max Weber has been more important for Jaspers than Wilhelm Dilthey, since Weber embodied for him the philosopher par excellence. Apart from this, a philosophical treatment of worldviews was paradigmatically introduced by Dilthey through the treatise Die Typen der Weltanschauungen und ihre Ausbildung in den metaphysischen Systemen, published in 1911. This work summarizes Dilthey's lifelong efforts to establish epistemologically the human studies, the Geisteswissenschaften, as an independent group of disciplines on the same level as the sciences of nature. Dilthey's concern for worldviews can be traced back to his early phases, but elaborated only in his last period. He attempted to develop a philosophy of philosophy, nowadays some would say a meta-philosophy, and concluded that there are worldviews that are not reducible to one another. The question of how to treat such a plurality of final perspectives becomes for Dilthey a problem, since he sees no possibility to mediate between them or to order somehow rationally such a multiplicity. In the final analysis, there are, in Dilthey's view, three basic types of worldviews. First, a naturalistic worldview with the primacy of the theoretical moment. Second, an objective idealistic worldview with the primacy of the emotional moment. And third, a freedom-centered worldview with the primacy of the voluntative moment. The resulting positions are then naturalism, the idealism of freedom, and objective idealism, so that these worldviews also serve as a basis for religion and literature. The relativistic flavor of the major argument hasn't remained hidden before Dilthey, as it is clear from the passage claiming that the struggle between the main types of worldviews remains. I quote, Religion wie Philosophie suchen Festigkeit, Wirkungskraft, Herrschaft, Allgemeingültigkeit. Aber die Menschheit ist auf diesem Weg nicht einen Schritt weitergekommen. Der Kampf der Weltanschauungen untereinander ist an keinem Hauptpunkt zu einer Entscheidung gelangt. Unquote. In addition to the relativity of the worldviews, we see Diltay's impact upon Jaspers in the methodology of his psychology. Consider the following characteristic passage. Bei jedem Geistestypus fragen wir nach seiner Struktur. Wir setzen voraus, nur solche anschauliche Ganzheiten der Weltanschauung Geistestypen zu nennen, die eine einheitliche Struktur haben. Diese einheitliche Struktur lässt sich oft in Formel fassen, die man dann das Prinzip des Typus nennen kann. Sie lässt sich manchmal mit einem Schlagwort bezeichnen, das die Idee des Typus zeigt. Jeder Typus als solcher ist ein unendliches Ganzes. Unquote. The structural and holistic approach is, beyond doubt, an heir of Diltay's idea of descriptive psychology, beschreibende Psychologie, as already mentioned by Mr. Ravanus, as opposed to explanative psychology. Even before psychology of worldviews, Jaspers developed a specific understanding of psychology, mobilizing much of the German Verstehen tradition. With regard to Jaspers' position, his concern was not only the relativity, but also aspects that were subordinated for Diltay. Worldviews had for Jaspers the same systematic position as objectivized cages or shells, Gehäuse, that have the function of protecting the individual from the infinite possibilities of evaluation and action. Jaspers' focus is directed on the closed form of such worldviews and their connection with living a human life and acting as a human being. He hasn't given a clear definition of worldview. At the outset of psychology of worldviews, the encompassing total character of worldviews is emphasized in accordance with ordinary usage. Worldview is contrasted with what is partial, be it knowledge or ethical and other principles. Jaspers introduces later a distinction between word picture, Weltbild, and attitudes. The former designates within the subject-object divide the object side, via the latter the subject side. I quote, sofern die Seele in der Subjekt-Objekt-Spaltung existiert, sieht die psychologische Betrachtung vom Subjekt her Einstellungen, vom Objekt her Weltbilder, unquote. A word picture is the totality of the object side content, gegenständliche Inhalte, that one has, and this leads to the concept of objectivated cage or shell. I quote the well-known passage. Wir können das Weltbild, das Gehäuse nennen, in das das seelische Leben teils eingefangen ist, dass es teils auch selbst aus sich zu schaffen und nach außen zu setzen vermag. Wir leben immerfort in einem solchen Gehäuse. Den äußersten Horizont unseres Weltbildes halten wir ganz unwillkürlich für einen absoluten. Unser Weltbild ist uns immer irgendwo und irgendwie letztlich selbstverständlich. Unquote. Word picture or word view is regarded here in terms of its evidential character, in terms of its unquestioned function of giving orientation. It is unavoidable to have a word view because it is unavoidable to act and to react. This function might be one of the reasons why Jaspers, although motivated by Max Weber, doesn't follow his entirely negative conception of worldviews. On the other hand, Jaspers requires a principal openness with regard to the content of our worldview. This requirement follows from his conviction that our worldview, our framework of orientation, has to be confronted, at least in principle, with experience. Jaspers claims that we get motivated to questioning because we get into conflict with reality, so that finally what happens differs from what we had expected. To be unable to make experiences in an emphatic sense means to become rigid in a framework of worldview, in a Gehäuse. The problematic aspect of this rigidity is for Jaspers that it creates a tendency of shielding us from boundary or limit situations, Grenzsituation. And this is a central aspect of the psychology of worldviews, that is the distinction between persons who are living with a point of reference in the infinity and persons who exist in rigid frameworks of orientation. Lastly, it should be noted that despite Jaspers' assurance concerning the continuity of his later work with the psychology of worldviews, the concept of worldview scarcely occurs in later writings. This could be partly explained by the fact that worldview is connected to the individual, and from the 30s on, Jaspers paid much less attention to the problems of the individual. However, the requirement of openness, which has been shown to be an implication of the treatment of worldviews, is integrated into the later concept of existential communication. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for this insightful presentation about Jaspers and Diltai and the concept of worldviews. And please ask your questions.
So one question I had in light of the themes that you stress in your paper is you have this combination of the Gehäuse acting as a kind of protection, but also requiring a kind of openness. On the face of it, there seems to be a bit of a tension there. So I was just wondering if you could say a little bit more about it, because it sounds as if an openness is required, that might seem to undermine the protective function of the of these shells.
The answer could run roughly as follows. We are able to act only insofar as we rely certain principles, attitudes, or certain pieces of knowledge. And that means that we cannot have an overall skepticism or method of doubting when we act. That is the reason why we need a somewhat stable framework of orientation if we want to act. But it doesn't change the fact that our framework of orientation may be challenged by certain experiences, certain situations or events may turn out otherwise as we expected. And this is the openness, let's put it this way, the ability to learn from experience, what Jaspers accentuates against the protective orientating function of Gehäuse or framework of reference.
I guess I was wondering whether is it that there are different aspects of experience that we have to remain open to that allows the protection to like remain in place, or
as far as I see, there is no differentiation of the concept of openness in Jaspers, and as I indicated, it remains the same in his later concept of existential communication in the three volume writing philosophy, where existential communication requires an absolute and radical openness to what the other person says. To us. So it's this openness, as far as I see, is unspecified. And I should add that I think Hans-Georg Gadamer had his emphasis on openness also in connection with the concept of experience from Karl Jaspers. They had a correspondence, and I couldn't check this connection yet, but it's quite so that there are indices that that Gadamer could have been motivated to his openness centered conception of interpretation by Jaspers' theory of interpretation, and as far as I see also in the discussion of philosophy of science, there is it's hard to settle criteria in advance which questions should be retreated or rediscussed.
Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah, Csaba, thanks very much for your paper. And I think I like your pointing at the fact that the term Weltanschauung is hard to translate, which I think is sometimes an indication that certain concepts exist more in one language or in one context, in one cultural context, and not so much in another. And I always struggle a little bit with Weltanschauung to make sense what this even means and whether it's even important philosophically. And so just something that I struggle about, for example, would be then the way that Jaspers takes this from Dilthey. So with Dilthey, with the quotation that you provided, it seems like worldviews have kind of an hegemonic aspiration that they want to be religious worldviews and then they want to encompass the whole culture, but then they can't anymore, and so on and so forth. What he does with the idea of a shell and a cage, which we need, but at the same time need to overcome, and then the openness seems to be something that really relativizes Weltanschauung. So it doesn't seem to be something that is then all that important anymore, wouldn't you say? So it kind of loses the hegemonic, cultural, ethnic, perhaps even nationalistic tones that it had still in the 19th century.
I would totally agree to the claim that that both in Dilthey and in Jaspers, worldview or Weltanschauung gets or obtains a very relativistic flavor, and I would say that that it's already true for Dilthey. It's a problem for him. He gave at his 70th birthday a talk in 1903 about his lifelong struggle for overcoming historical relativism. That is a consequence of the historicist research. He wanted to give a foundation, and it's obviously a failure for Dilthey that he couldn't find anything. His position, his final insights led to a relativism that he himself also wanted to avoid. But he couldn't. So in this sense, I think the relativistic style or coloring of the term is already present in Dilthey, and also of course also in Max Weber's famous critique in the talk Science as a Vocation. There you find worldviews on the same level as blind irrational decisions. Decision is what remains. So I wouldn't see there too much tension. What changes is that for Jaspers the existential orientation, the orientation for the individual comes rather into the fore.
Yeah, I mean, I just have a couple of comments and then a question as well. Mr. Ole referred to philosophy of science a little bit, and I was reminded of some of the debates in contemporary philosophy of science, particularly the discussion on Quine's famous thesis of underdetermination. Quine is, as all of us know, is a leading analytic philosopher and a philosopher of science as well. And he advocated this thesis of underdetermination as a naturalist. And he thinks that even in physics, when we collect all possible empirical evidence, experimental evidence, on the basis of the same evidence, we can build, worldviews which are empirically equivalent, but can be logically incompatible with each other. That is his, in a nutshell, his thesis of underdetermination. And Quine did not really want to yield to relativism, so he struggled very hard with this issue as to how to, avoid relativistic implications of the thesis of underdetermination. Subsequently, the discussion in philosophy of science has shown that probably he did not succeed. And it appears to me that Jaspers' viewpoint that worldviews as cages or as shells, where it's very hard to have a cross worldviews criteria to adjudicate between them. If that's not possible, even within a science, even within a naturalistic worldview, we can have more than one, versions which are totally incompatible with each other. My question is, my worry is, and it's not a new worry, it's there in the literature all along. Professor Ole, any suggestions as to how to explore this issue and maybe avoid relativism? Your comments, please.
I think that there are relativistic implications in Jasper's position here. There is a parallel which is drawn by the Austrian philosopher Kurt Salamon between Karl Popper and Jaspers. Popper brought the idea of falsification by experience very early in 1930-35 already into the discussion. But to answer your question, there are no pre-settled criteria for determining which events would so to say falsify my frame of reference, I think that it's both impossible on the individual level for the existing individual, and it's also impossible in scientific research or inquiry, which was pointed out by later discussions of Popperian falsification. On the other hand, I think that we could imagine situations where the frame of reference or the bundle of values one has as an existing individual become to some extent challenged or questioned, and it is this situation Jaspers wants to address with the requirement of openness, even if there are no clear-cut criteria for such situations.
If I may, are we, is there a way for us to, let us say, distinguish between pluralism of worldviews on the one hand and relativism on the other? Because obviously pluralism need not necessarily logically imply relativism. We could say that for now, we do not really have cross worldviews criteria to adjudicate between worldviews, but at the end of the road, ideally one day we might have. And therefore, currently, in the current state of scientific knowledge, even if there is a plurality of worldviews, that does not mean that truth is relative ultimately. Our reality can be viewed only through the lenses of particular shells and cages and worldviews. That we may not draw the relativistic conclusion while keeping, open the possibility that ultimately, we may have cross-cultural or cross-worldview criteria and negotiate and get to what might be a realist view of truth and reality rather than a relativistic one.
I think Jaspers discusses this problem in the psychology of worldviews on the level of individuals, and he's much less cared about an absolute objective truth. And that was what my talk about relativistic flavor referred to.
Taking this up, I wonder if you can't distinguish between pluralism and relativism, but also drop out the realist presumption. So it seems to me that having plural views doesn't necessarily commit one to relativism, as long as those plural views are anchored in a comprehensive framework. And I actually tend to find that the worries about relativism come from a philosophical conception like that of paupers that's really alien to the Kantian tradition in which I would situate Jaspers.
I think, I can only repeat to some extent what I've already said, that here in the context of psychology of worldviews, Jaspers is not concerned with the question of an overall truth. He describes the individuals as having having certain point of views or perspectives or frameworks of orientation, and that means that if we want to address the distinction between pluralism and relativism, then we move out of the context of the psychology of worldviews. But to say something very briefly to this, I would say that if we have a pluralistic view of the possible opinions and perspectives, then we are in the sense on a relativistic path that either we find ways and methods to decide which view of the many is more probable or more reliable, or we cannot find such a method. And if we don't find such a method, then it's simply claiming that there is a reality. We could have a realist account, even if there are a lot of very different views of what there is. But again, I think that this problem is not Jaspers' question in this book.
Yeah, so one point, he does look at these typologies and that assumes that you can sort of stand off from commitment to them. And that typology is ultimately grounded in the existential choices that one makes. So it seems to me that the existential choices, one's being in the world, as it were, provides the supra world conceptual framework here.
I would say that existential choices may go in different directions. And the Jaspers always carefully describes, let's say, bad answers and good answers to limit situations, to boundary situations. If it turns out that I have COVID virus and my illness is very serious, then Jaspers would say that there is a let's say an existential reaction to it. If I grasp myself as the single individual who happened to have this fate, and there are the bad reactions to this. So I would say that because of this plurality of let's say authentic and inauthentic or good or bad reactions, you cannot rely on a kind of overall objectivist picture on this possibility.
You have spoken of subject-object splitting and always of relativism, pluralism, and not from ideology, not. You are from Hungary. See you a connection with Lukács Verdinglichung, rather with Tiltei. I think at the debate with Lukács from Jaspers. Jaspers has spoken from subject-object splitting, but he has not found a connection with the Verdinglichung of Lukács, but you are from Ungarn. Can you say something to that problem?
I heartily say at any time something about Lukács. It's a complex issue because both Jaspers and Lukács belonged to the intimate circle of Max Weber, and so they could have some informations about each other. I don't really think that that the reification theory of Lukács has much to do with the subject object the divide in Jaspers if you look at Lukács' work, I refer now to the Marxist the revolutionary Marxist period and primarily to his masterpiece History and Class Consciousness, that's a very Hegelian book. Hegel plays the most important or let's put it this way, a Marx filled with a lot of Hegel and with a lot of totality. That's the basis of Lukács' position when he describes reification, Verdinglichung. And I don't really think that there is too much place, too much room for the individual. The individual simply doesn't exist for Lukács' description of reification. That's the standpoint of the proletariat. I would say that that basic assumptions of Lukács are very, very far away from the individualist interests of Karl Jaspers, and you could continue these differences. For example, by saying that Lukács is oriented towards the future with a progressive idea of Marxism, as opposed to Jaspers, who once said that he reads only books that are older than 2,000 years. I don't really see a connection there. It's worth noting that Lucien Goldman, a student of Lukács, formulated the claim that the early Lukács, the Lukács of the Zeeland Formen, was the first existentialist philosopher, because in the Metaphysics of Tragedy, that's an essay in this collection, in the Metaphysics of Tragedy, Lukács describes authentic life as a life ending tragically in suicide, because that's the only possibility to live an authentic life. There is this interesting, and I don't think very plausible interpretation of the very early Lukács, but that's not the middle period, not the period of Verdinglichung or reification.
We move on to our next speaker. Next speaker is Stefano Papa. Stefano Papa, Mr. Papa, has studied classical philology at the University of Trieste in Italy, before he then moved to Vienna in Austria, where he studied philosophy, mathematics, and formal logic. He is a lecturer for philosophy at the University of Vienna and applied professor at the Vienna Private Webster University. He is specialized in the philosophy of classical mechanics, philosophical logic in the sense of logic of questions, and political philosophy, especially in theories of welfareism. He has published papers on Immanuel Kant, Georg Friedrich Wilhelm Hegel, Hermann Cohen, and the logic of action.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here. And let me also begin, like my fellow panelists just did, with some remarks on the term worldview, Weltanschauung, I think Karl Barth's commentary on the Epistle to the Romans appeared just a few months before Karl Jaspers' book. And in that book by Karl Barth, the term worldview also appears and plays a major role. One of the theses of the book is that one is not allowed, from his point of view, to use, so to speak, the Christian worldview for other worldviews. For example, Karl Barth says, you can and should go to the military service, but not as a military chaplain. And you can, of course, engage yourself in a social democratic movement, but not as a Christian. In those years, the term stood for clash of worldviews, like we talk or we used to talk 10 years ago about the clash of civilizations. So worldview was a charged term, a word, ein Reizwort, the German would say, in those years. And for Karl Jaspers, the term, as I see it, as I read the book, obviously has to be put in the context, in the post-Hegelian context. The book ends with a section headed The Life of Spirit. And much has been just said about Diltai. With Diltai, we are in in the midst of post-Hegelian philosophy. Diltai takes over the Hegelian project of a theory of the objective spirit, but with an important modification. Diltai says, according to Hegel, objective spirit is the hinge between subjective spirit, the life of individuals, if you will, and the absolute spirit. Now we, so Diltai, are not allowed anymore to see it in this way because we deal with positivity. what he means by that is that he means his own method of verstehende Psychologie, of his understanding modeled after the theory of the Geisteswissenschaften, of philology and history and so on. With Diltai, the Hegelian idea of objective spirit has a subjective term. With Diltai, the idea that objective spirit is, for Hegel, philosophy and religion and so on, is abandoned. Everything is, so to speak, is projected onto the subjective spirit. Now, even in the beginning words of the introduction, Jaspers says that the label worldview is meant to address totalities. But of course, Jaspers is not Hegelian. The key word of his philosophy here is irreducibility. Is a Kierkegaardian stance. Conflicts, negativity cannot be reduced or resolved via conceptual means, like in Hegel, but also in Husserl. Yeah, our host has mentioned Jaspers' general psychopathology of 1913, and there, and in a paper of the same year, Jaspers takes issue with Husserl. Husserl is the hero of the phenomenological movement, and more than Diltai, is someone like Weber, who stands for an intellectual discipline, for a methodological consciousness. And this is the second key word in our book. So we have irreducibility, the impossibility to reduce conflicts, negativity, pain and suffering to a conceptual issue, and methodological consciousness. the main, to conclude about worldviews, the main question is, can there be a representation of a totality, of a concrete totality, in Hegelian terms of the objective spirit, or in the Jaspersian terms of a worldview? Can there be can an individual, so to speak, embody a worldview? One question is answered right away by Jaspers. A worldview cannot be reduced to knowledge. Is not a kind of world of knowledge representation. So about method and methodology and phenomenology, Jaspers is an admirer of Husserl, as much as he will hate Heidegger, despite the fact that there was a correspondence and so on. But he also thinks that Husserl betrays the particulars, the individuals. So there is, of course, the Weberian and the Husserlian stance in our book in Psychology of Worldviews, and there is this this consciousness that descriptions, like in the general pathology, and have to be modeled after a scientific method. I mean, in general psychopathology of 1913, Jaspers is obviously an epistemological dualist. He takes as his model Kraepelin, and he values phenomenology in medical terms as the exact description of symptoms, as much as the uses of the scientific method of explanation. And he says, of course, polemically, that psychopathology is not a science of the brain, but nevertheless uses also results of in neurology. So there is this this idea that descriptions, the descriptive method, has to be warranted and has to be measured after the best science we have. This is very important for us, for a reader in the 21st century, of course. So about limit situations, in the literature there is an ongoing debate as to the fact that Jaspers does not distinguish between boundary situations, particular situations, and certain necessary conditions of human life. This debate is misleading, in my opinion, because of the reason I just mentioned. Of course, there is a phenomenology of limit situations in our book, in the sense that some existential types are described. But this is exactly the point. The limit situation is something which concerns concerns an individual in a unique way. And it's the response of the individual which decides about the possibility of transitioning to existing from Dasein, from merely living, or from partly living, as one could also say. One more remark, and then we can go to the discussion. In philosophy, in his major work in the middle period, but also in Von der Wahrheit, of Truth, his philosophical logic, his monumental philosophical logic, published in 1948, Jaspers comes back again and again to the concept of limit situation, of boundary conditions, and so on, and tries to refine it. In philosophy, there is this identity statement that experiencing limit situations, Grenzsituationen, and existieren, are the same. But in our book, in Psychology of Worldviews, Jasper says that for humans to establish themselves within a boundary situation is an impossibility. So there is a tension here between two different conceptions of boundary conditions or boundary situation. On the one side, in his more mature work, you have this identity statement that experiencing the limit situation is eo ipso existing. So it is a kind of authenticity. But in Psychology of Worldview, we have this negation that there cannot be really an experience of limit situation. And by way of a conclusion about politics and about science and so on, authenticity, one of the limit situation or of the boundary situations Jasper addresses are, one of the five is guilt. And guilt, of course, means for him, first of all, the situation of the Germans after the Second World War. There is this moral guilt of people involved in the, concretely involved in the homicide and mass murder of fellow citizens and adversaries and so on. And there is also the political responsibility. Jasper says in his work on guilt that being in this limit situation for a people, so for a collective agent, comes with the possibility of inaugurating a way of a policy of non-domination. So this authenticity transcends the sphere of the individual agent and inaugurates the possibility of for a collective agent to embody a form of authenticity. And in a similar fashion, also the possibility of self-destruction, the existential threat represented by nuclear weapons, is addressed in the same way. Here, Jasper says, let me find the quote, and this is my last word, this is my conclusion. He says, in The Atom Bomb and the Future of Man, the original published 1958, either all mankind will physically perish or there will be a change in the moral political condition of man. And this change in the moral political condition of man is also addressed in his philosophical logic, where he speaks of a totaler Kommunikationswille. So this is also a form of authenticity, of existing, which involves an individual in the frame of a political body and political institutions. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you very much for these interesting presentations. I would like to address two points. First, the problem of limit situations or boundary situations. And secondly, that's also a limit situations for a people. So that's the political problem. I couldn't really see the problem or your problem with the distinction between limit situations and situations in general or particular situations, because we get from Jasper's the view that a limit situation or boundary situation is a case or a situation where we simply can cannot get along with our knowledge, with our normal and usual ways of tackling problems. And in this sense, limit situations are different from ordinary situations. So the question would be what is here the problem with this distinction? And I would like to add that the tension you mentioned between psychology and of worldviews and philosophy doesn't really seem to be a real one because in the psychology of worldviews, Jasper says that in a limit situation we come to a limitation of our existence. We simply cannot do things as we did earlier, and that's the point of the quotation of philosophy: existieren und Grenzsituationen erfahren ist dasselbe. I don't really see here clearly the tension. The second point would be that the late Jaspers tried to apply the concept of limit situation to a whole people. But it's obvious that this is an attempt which is not in every point or not at every point convincing, because as you mentioned, it would assume that we have a plausible description of a collective agent which is able to make decisions and with regard to which we could reasonably ask whether it's an authentic agent or not. It's easy for an individual to ask whether he or she is himself or herself, but for a group of individuals, it's much less obvious. Thank you.
So the first point, limit situation and necessary conditions of human life. I was referring to the secondary literature here, mm-hmm. but I find this is a real point. Because as I said, and as I think it's true, the methodological question is very important in our book. So there is a problem with this type token difference. This is not necessarily a limitation. Yeah, and I think one has to make an important distinction: the limit situations. So struggle, death, and guilt. We readers of the 21st century, we are in danger of misunderstanding this concept of limit situations, because we could also say that taking part in a marathon is a limit situation, insofar as I am pushed towards my limits, and during the competition, I really face exhaustion and so on. And in this situation, I experience myself as being really myself in an authentic way. This is, of course, not what is meant. The limit situation has a unique appeal to me. I am the actor or of the limit situation. And it cannot be someone else. At the same time, I cannot establish myself as the author of the limit situation. This is what I meant by the fact that the limit situation, and this is the point in psychology of worldviews, this narrative instability is stressed. I cannot be the author, but I am the actor. The second moment or the second leap of the limit situation is that I develop an interest for universal history. So universal history, and Jaspers is remembered also for the axial theory, the theory of the axial age. This interest for universal history is a consequence, so to speak, of this authenticity or existing. And the third moment is that experiencing a limiting situation is a moment of connectedness. There is not a single leap, but there is a manifold of leaps, and this is actually the answer to the critics who say that Jaspers is an irrationalist, because one leap implies the other. There is a mutual implication. So this idea of being in a limit situation comes with an intellectual or an epistemic discipline, if you will. So about the idea that a collective cannot be authentic, a people cannot be authentic. I totally agree. Living in Austria, I cannot but agree. But on the other side, we can see this as a social experiment by Jaspers. Of course, a failed social experiment to try to trigger an existential communication, an existential exchange. In the wake of the post-war consciousness of being guilty. I mean, what we experience now, for example, with ecological movement or with Me Too, this shows, I think, very concretely how moments of inauthenticity, the political correctness, for example, and on the other side of certain movements being progressive signs, because of course we all welcome this, but there are sides to it which we find unpalatable. They do not taste us, especially if we are in a certain age. Yeah, being over 40, for example, we have been trained and educated in another atmosphere, so we find certain things like using gendering, for example. But as a father of a daughter, I cannot but welcome this movement. So I would say a collective cannot be authentic in this sense that authenticity comes at the price of rhetoric and, you know, indulging in this micropolitics of language and so on.
Mr. Papa, can you do some... throw some further light on this notion of irreducibility. A reduction in philosophy of science basically means that if, for example, we can explain all the concepts of Newtonian mechanics within the framework of Einsteinian relativity, we will say that Newtonian mechanics is reducible to Einsteinian relativity. So although philosophers of science do not agree that that is possible, but there is the idea of reduction or reducibility. But how do you use the word reducibility, or how does Jaspers use the word reducibility or irreducibility in connection with worldviews?
I wouldn't agree with you that Newtonian mechanics being expressible in terms of general relativity means that Newtonian mechanics is being reduced. Of course, we speak of reductionism when we try to use, for example, thermodynamics to explain communication phenomena. This is a kind of reductionism. We say that there is some noise and we cannot understand each other anymore because of the use of different blah, 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 blah. And we use here another language. This is reductionism, and it is and it was an issue, not only in philosophy of science, but also in philosophy in general at the beginning of the last century and also in this century. By irreducibility, I mean the idea that on the one hand, Husserlian phenomenology has this idea of reduction, the transcendental reduction, and also the reduction to psychology, for example. So Husserl comes and sells us vacuum cleaners, saying, yeah, okay, here I have a method for a rigorous science, philosophy as a rigorous science. This reduction as a guarantee, as a warrant of professionalism, so to speak, in philosophy, is both something which fascinates Jaspers, but he cannot accept it totally, because it means that existence, that life, to speak in Diltayan terms, is reduced to concepts, or in Husserlian terms, to essences. So comes at the price of essentialism. Another kind of reductionism is what Husserl addresses as psychologism, for example, or historicism. And this is the claim that the categories, also the categories used in scientific explanations, are variables. They are not given once and for all, but they change, as Thomas Kuhn taught us they do, with paradigm shifts. So on the one side, we have the problem of adopting a naturalistic stance, like, for example, Quine would do, or Carnap, or in the tradition of Diltai, adopting the point of view of history, basically. The German word Geisteswissenschaften is very difficult to be translated, almost impossible, because it always comes with this Hegelian taste to it. So this this issue of reducibility of something, for example, reducibility of something given in an encounter, in an objectual encounter, to a type, in Weberian term, to an ideal type, is on the one side the thing which makes it possible to make something methodically accessible for other people, so to talk and to understand each other. But from the point of view of existentialism and of Jaspers, is also something which betrays and sacrifices exactly the source of authenticity from the standpoint, from the viewpoint of Jaspers. This is the individual existing and being in a limit situation.
Well, yeah, I guess just a quick footnote. Kuhn's incommensurability thesis is basically irreducibility thesis across the paradigms. So if that's what we mean by it, then according to, you know, analytic philosophers like Davidson, that thesis is blatantly false, because if we cannot translate one paradigm into another, then there is no way, or one language into another, then there is no way for us to claim that this noise or these marks are really language. So on his famous paper on the very idea of a conceptual scheme, Davidson argues against such irreducibility or incommensurability. But it's just a footnote, not a question.
Right now, referring to your statement, Stefano, of that Husserl has said, or that Jaspers had said, that Husserl betrays the individuals. I'm not sure whether I have understood you correctly there, and I'd like you to clarify this. In my understanding, this quite famous word from Jaspers, that Husserl has betrayed the philosophy, is more a methodological thing, and not an that Jaspers claims that Husserl has done some betrayal to mankind itself or to people or whatever, but to philosophy, to reduce or to, in a certain sense, claim that philosophy should be a rigid science. In my point of view, this is Jasper's point, that this is not possible and this is not philosophy. And this is a portrayal, in Jasper's view, which Husserl has done. Do you agree, or would you say this is something different?
The point is, of course, a point of method. It's not like with Heidegger. Heidegger claims that there is always something which phenomenology, in the Husserlian sense, forgets, and this is being in the world, and so on and so forth. If you stick to this distinction, analytic and continental, but Heidegger is perfectly on the side of Quine, for example, taking structures, taking wholes for granted, like language. If you think that the medium of reflection, the medium of philosophy is language, whatever language, a formal language or a natural language, then of course you perfectly agree with Heidegger and you disagree with Husserl. From the point of view of Jaspers, the point is exactly this, a point of method, of methodology. I mean, we can go back to the psychopathology. For exactly this reason, Jaspers in the last consequence, he rejects Freud, for example. Freud and every kind of speculative psychology, because they project onto the individual, onto the suffering individual, they project something, they their constructions and so on, and something which they can basically not observe and not verify. So from this point of view, there is not really an abysm between Popper and Jaspers. Verifiability, falsifiability, they are rational points which cannot really be rejected by any person properly reflecting and understanding the problem. I am not sure if I can come back to this point that we can conflate, or we should conflate, incommensurability and reducibility. And
incommensurability and irreducibility.
Yeah. I'm not sure they mean the same.
Okay, that's fine. But most philosophers of science think that they do.
Not even that, because okay.
We have to move on to our next speaker. Hannah Rindermann has studied psychology as major and philosophy as minor at Ruprecht Karls University in Heidelberg, so in the city where Jaspers also was at the university a long time, and earned its PhD in psychology there in 1995. After that, he continued his studies and got the Venia Legendi for psychology 2005 at the University of Landau in Germany also. Then he fulfilled different academic roles, ranging from lecturer to interim professor at universities of Munich, Magdeburg, Kassel, Saarbrücken, and Paderborn, all in Germany, until he accepted a professorship in Graz in Austria. He has been in Graz from 2008 to 2010. And then finally, in 2010, he became professor for psychology in Chemnitz in Germany, which ends his academic years of travel. He is nowadays tenured professor of educational and developmental psychology at Chemnitz University of Technology. Mr. Rindermann has unfolded an extensive publication activity in the last 25 years. His most recent monographic study deals with the topic of human capital and the well-being of nations, and was published in 2018 by Cambridge University Press.
I want to give a quick overview on the book, about the book, and I want to describe how Jaspers' Psychologie der Weltanschauung can be picked up in research, and what I think the most important form of reception of Jaspers' work would be, and this is not a scientific adoption in a more in a narrow sense, but adoption in living and thinking as an existence. Okay, starting with the overview. Paradoxically, Karl Jaspers coming into his own philosophy occurred in a book that has psychology in its title, namely the book we are speaking today about, Theorie der Weltanschauung. Similarly paradoxical is the fact that Jaspers rejected in this preface any normative content, but the book is full of normative stances, for example, in favor of Bildung, in the German broad emphatic sense, in favor of thinking, of knowledge, enthusiasm in science, in communication, in life and love, based on values that refer to the transcendent or to the Ganze, to the whole. Simultaneously, the Psychology of Values is a very classical German philosophy book that is based on Hegel, Dilthey, and Kant, yet Jaspers linked them to enthusiastic thinkers such as Nietzsche and Kierkegaard, what was really a new combination, and was opening thus the way to existence philosophy. So let's speak about the term worldview. Karl Jaspers understands worldview as the whole of an outlook consisting of knowledge and values which guides the view of the world and of people and of one's own life. What is psychology of worldviews? And the core of a psychology of worldviews is the investigation of psychological contents and structures of psychological development conditions of certain worldviews and of consequences of different worldviews on the life of people, especially on the individual life of persons. However, sociological, historical, or in the broader sense, any kind of empirical investigation was not intended by Jaspers in the psychology of worldviews. Some comments on the structure of Jaspers' Theorie der Weltanschauung. Jaspers' book is based on a theoretical concept of the Hegelian triad, roughly speaking, as a thesis, an antithesis, and a synthesis. And this synthesis should be a integration, a higher alternative to the first two concepts or terms, a sublation, eine Aufhebung. There are three main chapters about Einstellung, attitudes, Weltbilder, world models, and Leben des Geistes, life of the spirit. And in this triad, we can see the thesis, the antithesis, and sublation, integration of attitudes and world models. And the chapter attitudes, but this chapter is most strongly influenced by Solovey and when we compare the different parts of his book. In Jaspers' psychology of worldviews, not so much worldviews of existing religions and people are analyzed, but rather worldviews of a philosophical origin and especially of notable philosophers as individuals. Essential ideas that can be found again in later works of Jaspers are developed in this book, The Psychology of Worldviews. In addition, it contains a systematic outline of Occidental and worldwide philosophy. For the reader, this systematic sketch can be used as an introduction into philosophy. It's like a global, very broad introduction into philosophical works. Jaspers did not define his terms and concepts very precisely. All terms are highly abstract, interpretively open, and have an excess of meaning. This openness and concealment are based on the intention to think for yourself as a reader and as an existence. From an empirical cognitive perspective, the openness of terms may in fact stimulate one's own thinking. It's like in creativity research, if you have an enigma, this stimulates thinking. However, from the perspective of scientific disciplines, we need more precise terms, or we need to define them. we have heard about Gehäuse, shell, another important term, Halt im Unendlichen, foothold in the infinity. Then we also have heard about limit situation, Grenzsituation, Enthusiasm, Enthusiasmus, Subject-Object-Spaltung, Subject-Object-Split, Dialectics, Dialektik, das Ganze, the whole, the ritual, Einzelne, Redlichkeit, Truthfulness, Honesty, Idea, then distinguishing between Reason, Vernunft, Logos and Verstand, Faith, Glaube, and finally, Existence. In philosophy, as an academic discipline, Jasper's work can be hermeneutically and scholarly interpreted compared with other works in philosophers and historically analyzed. For example, the position of Theorie der Weltanschauung in the history of ideas in philosophy or in Jasper's own development of thinking. In psychology and in the social sciences, sociology, pedagogics, cross-cultural research, economics, worldviews in religion or worldviews in politics and in culture in general, worldviews as they are communicated, published, or worldviews as they are lived in everyday life can be analyzed and their impact on life and life outcomes be estimated. However, both are disciplinary philosophical or disciplinary psychological empirical analysis of worldviews lacks the core objective of Jasper's thinking and of his psychology of worldviews, as I think. Such disciplinary and empirical approaches represent a productive misunderstanding of Jasper's main intention of recognizing and living philosophy as an existence. For Jasper's passed down philosophy, as we can read in from Augustinus to Nietzsche, is a product of bygone thinking by thinkers. Jasper's book writing of his psychology of worldviews should be seen as a process of organizing, understanding, and evaluation of other thinkers by Jasper's. And for readers, it is intended to be a point of departure, a beginning point for engaging in their own thinking. This thinking should be part of a reflected life. Thinking and acting should refer to intellectual ideas and the whole. In practical terms, this could protect humans against aberrances of thinking and science, in, for example, politicization, indolence, or narrowness, and lead to a more reasonable, freer, and intellectually more stimulating as well, truthful thinking. Thank you very much.
This is, might be quite a minor point because it concerns something that you mentioned in a footnote. But you talk at one point about Jasper's endorsing enthusiasm across the board. And then in one of the footnotes, you present us with some dichotomies, which I take it are meant to articulate what enthusiasm is. But I guess I thought that later on in your later discussion, it seemed a bit less clear that Jasper's would be endorsing what I believe is, if you like, the enthusiastic side of each of these dichotomies. So just, you know, the emotional, the rational, the wild and the serious, because later on you stress the way in which a certain notion of seriousness is very important to Jasper's. So as I say, this might be quite a minor point because it's only something in a footnote, but it caught my eye that the footnote seems to suggest, the main text seemed to be suggesting at the start that Jasper's sides with enthusiasm. The footnote then suggests that siding with enthusiasm would, as it were, oppose him to seriousness. But later in the paper, it sounds like seriousness is a more important notion than that would suggest.
What is the central concept in this book? And we have spoken before about Gehäuse and Grenzsituationen and Bilthey's influence. I read this book with 19 years or 19 to 20 years, and this was also Jasper's first book. And for me, the central or the most important concept in the book was enthusiasm. how the enthusiasm in love and also his relationship to what is in other books and his autobiography to his wife and Gertrude. And but it's I think different people can come to different conclusions what is his most important concept in his book. But I think this is enthusiasm. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. But of course, Jasper, he was in this age also younger, and he later is a little bit distanzieren himself from this book of his own youth. Only presenting the ideas of former thinkers and so on, this would not be the central aim of Jaspers. He wanted to show that people should think by themselves and live a reflected life, but not in a dry way, but in a enthusiastic way.
Mm-hmm. I would have a short semantic question concerning the use of worldview in psychology and social science. Would you agree that worldview in these domains roughly signifies the same as ideology? What I have in mind is the global character of worldview. Because if we make a research, let's say about the Yalth or whatever, then we would use the term worldview and also ideology if we want a more global, want to get a more global picture of a certain person or a certain group and so on. So how do you see this?
Yeah. If you subtract from the term or concept ideology the negative connotations, then I would say it's the same like worldviews. But usually ideology is a way of incorrect thinking or a bias in thinking, in like introduced by Karl Mannheim and similar thinkers. But if you subtract yes. this negative connotation, this bias, then it's the same.
Quite at the beginning of your explanation, you have started with mentioning that Jaspers has, in a certain way, the worldview of great thinkers and other philosophers, and you have given us the names Nietzsche, Kierkegaard, Kant, and Hegel, and so on, and that this is a kind of that Jaspers focuses analysis around thinkers like this. And I was wondering, and I'm interested in hearing your opinion to this, whether it would make more sense or make sense at all when Jaspers would have considered more, let's say, symbolic forms, to use Liz Cassiro terms, of life than he actually had. So, for example, all the pluralities of religion, of art, of different types of culture and something like this seems to play, if at all, an only minor role inside of the psychology of worldviews. So should Jaspers have taken more cultural factors into account in this book? What do you think?
If his intention would be a traditional overview on different worldviews, yes, he should do it. But this, I think, it was not his intention. His intention was to use thinking of other people to develop own thinking. And so it's not so important to drop up every, for example, cultural production and so on, to understand and for example, to observe people in their everyday life and then extract their culture. And this was not the intention of Jaspers. Mm-hmm. And this would not be so important. Mm-hmm. He want to examine speak in a poetic way, for example, with path thinkers, to speak with Augustinus, with him, and to imaginative communication between Augustinus and Jaspers, and develop in this way his own existence.
I totally agree that it's not about just collecting the different historical forms of worldviews and something mm-hmm. like this, mm-hmm. but broaden a little bit the the empirical background. We try to see our phenomenon in different circumstances, in different situations, and so on. So to be sure that we have everything which is essential to that specific phenomenon. And when sometimes, in my opinion, I really wonder about that Jaspers didn't pay more attention to two different cultural factors which might influence also worldviews and take a look at different cultures, different forms of art, of religious living. To his intention clearly was not to deliver something like a descriptive psychology as Diltai, but he was on the track of his verstehende Psychologie, an interpretative psychology. And sometimes I wonder why he hasn't broadened his scope a little bit.
I think this is a good question, and it would be possible to add a second book to Jaspers' Theory of Worldviews containing such analysis. Yes?
Mm-hmm. The reason that he doesn't do that is that his interests are relatively narrow in that period. It's only later that he actually develops this interest in a world philosophy, situated very much in the Weber circle, and looks at the world from that point of view. And in that respect, I think his both his philosophical education and his just general way of looking at things is actually less universal than that of Kassirer at the same time.
As you mentioned, later on he draws more on Confucius and so on, and so he broadens his perspective.
So I see this more as a temporary thing, and in a way he's to be praised as a philosopher, as one of the first people to actually appreciate the importance of having a truly world philosophy that includes all cultures in a comprehensive viewpoint. Now, he still doesn't look to anthropology and things like that, but you can easily see how that could have been incorporated into the project. So I see him more developing in that direction, and it's perhaps because, you know, he's making the transition from a psychiatrist to a psychologist to a philosopher, and that's already taking on board a good deal of new material. So it takes him a while before he can then branch out to a truly world philosophical perspective.
But your remarks regarding the relationship between worldviews and economic development of or the disparity of economic development between various peoples of the world. Now this. I'm not sure, there are no empirical studies, and it may be the case that there is some relationship between the worldviews and economic development, but a lot of the time when it comes from the West, it is viewed in the lesser developed countries as a kind of arrogance, reflection of a mindset which fails to recognize the, you know, huge historical role which colonialism has played in bringing the wealth of the world into the West. I mean, India, for example, was the leading economic power prior to being colonized, but the British colonization period, it reduced it to one of the poorest countries. And the same goes in other regions of the world. So, and now they are struggling to come out of, you know, the negative psychological, economic, social impact of that period, but still neo-colonialism continues. And the economic order of the world is heavily tilted in favor of the, you know, developed nations of the world. So I'm not sure if, you know, if there is any real solid empirical evidence related to the claim that, you know, cultural worldviews are responsible in some ways for the lack of or, you know, lower level of development in certain regions of the world.
Yeah, this is an old battle between historical explanations and materialistic explanations and more cultural or ideological explanations. And there are some case studies, for example, on the effects of Protestantism in indigenous people in Latin America, and is showing that the Protestant that tribes where Protestantism was introduced changed their behavior, for example, going to medical doctors and not to healers, and behave in a more strategically economic way, and in the long run, improving their life situations. Everybody or the people who claiming that cultural factors are important, they do not exclude that other factors also play a role for explaining wealth differences. The most obvious are raw material or for example, if a country has oil resources in the ground and so on. So this is obvious that not only culture, but also other factors play a role.
Asking for an overarching worldview, as nice as it sounds, but the possibility for such an overarching worldview, unless anyone can think of other variables, would have to be found either in a unified understanding as to what is a human being, or to be found in some form of imperialistic suppression of a dominant worldview that then shows by its force that it can outsmart all the other perspectives of the world. And as such, we would then look at it as a desirable direction to go. So from a philosophical perspective, probably the question would be, is it possible to come to an understanding as to what is a human life, right? And what are the variables that we as humans would consider as valuable and desirable? And to take that outside of an anthropological perspective, is always going to take place within the domain at the parameters of a given culture, where the recruitment of that culture then either is effective for making sure that its citizens comply with the variables that are being established. Look in the contrast, say, you know, a Chinese culture versus the newly forming American culture, or an established Russian or European culture. Where do you see the possibility of coming to some kind of agreement other than in the context of perhaps economic domination? So when we ask for when the claim comes to, you know, why did the Jaspers not come up with a comprehensive understanding of what, you know, what kind of worldview would be preferable? Is it even possible? Can we even theoretically agree on what would be the parameters that allow us to to even assume the remote possibility of compliance with a given selection of worldviews. I remember the anthropological work of Richard Sorensen, who worked for the Smithsonian Institute and collected a vast material of visual images related to what he called pre-conquest societies. So these were societies mm-hmm. that lived their traditional ways until then they were, you know, so to speak, discovered, and of course discovered for their resources and for the expectation of whatever these countries had to offer, mostly island communities. Mm-hmm. And when he describes the psychological implications that the interaction with the conquerors has, it ultimately resulted in the collapse of their system that they had for, you know, extensive periods of times built and developed. Merely the fact of being exposed to 16 millimeter film showings created a clash of perception where suddenly you are confronted with a virtual reality, something that, you know, for us nowadays is the norm, but the virtual reality, not in the context of a Zoom setting, but say a virtual reality in the context of deepfake imagery. And, you know, if you're a little bit familiar with the deepfake imagery, it would be that any one of us here could actually be someone else. And none of us, not even your mother, would notice it. Right? And that is the capacity of high developed technology. So in this context, as we search for the difference between the soul searching of an individual to become an authentic human, right? And early on the reference, I think Csaba made to Lukács, and you know that the ultimate, the truthful end would be actually to commit suicide, right? At the end of your physical and mental strengths. You know, it's a question that probably all of us at one point in our lives go through. And then depending on whether or not, you know, we do it or not do it, it's an individual choice. But there is something to be, you know, to be reflected upon. At what point is the authenticity of living one's life solely a responsibility of an individual? Or to what extent can it be delegated to the authority of, say, the psychiatrist or the psychologist who is now through counseling, kind of coaching people as to what it is that they have to understand their life to be? So in, you know, making it short and perhaps bringing the focus to the Psychologie der Weltanschauung, and to what extent I do not have, I'm very skeptical about, even though I would like to bank on the idea that there would be something like an agreeable component as to what it is to be a human being and then striving towards that achievement, like in the old German Bildungspolitik. But I understand as time moves on that this already is a very culturally heavy concept and can easily be interpreted by someone from a different culture with a totally different lifestyle as an attempt to dominate a firearm, as many of you probably might remember. He was very polemic about that, you know, in his entertaining way, would point out as, you know, what does our discussion have any worth to, say, a baker in a village in Italy, right? Or even, you know, in more abstract terms. So it's in that sense, unless you accept the desirability of the concept of what it means to be a human being and to come to a universal answer to that question, what other variable would you perceive as being a realistic or a desirable variable for a unifying idea of a Weltanschauung?
Two answers possible. The first question would be, what are the different values different people, cultures have? Then we have empirical sources like the World Value Survey. They repeated every every, I don't know, 5 or 10 years, World Radio Survey by Engelhardt and other people. And so we can compare different cultures and what are the different values. And at the end, you can extract where the different cultures are most similar in which values, or which values in different cultures are most highly regarded. For example, what could be such values? Health, or a family, not living alone. I think such values, different people, different cultures can come together and can find an agreement. The other approach would be what had been the values, what we can extract from Jasper's book and from Jasper's books, several books, and from his own life. And I think he would be very on the individualistic side of a continuum between individualism and collectivism. He's a classical European scholar, and in his book, Psychological Values, he frequently speaks of the Einzelne, and Kierkegaard and Nietzsche are some examples of individualistic, independent thinkers, and compared to other cultures, and even compared to European history, I would say that Jaspers is very much on the side of individualistic, independent thinking, but integrated in a Diade, more abstractly formulated in communication, and more concretely in his Diade with his wife and Gertrude.
Absolutely so. It is, however, in, you know, even if we take what we normally would consider as, you know, unquestionable variables that would be of importance to anybody, take the point you made with regards to family. There is the distinction between the chosen family and the birth family. With regards to medicine, you can either believe into modern medicine as the panacea of all ills. You can also have a questionable position about it. Let's put it in the context of, say, healthcare in the United States. There's probably barely a developed country, so to speak, that has so many ill people living in it, which is a variable of our time. Just by coincidence, a book that just came out pointing out that the third highest cause in America for death, guess what it is?
Obesity, or not?
If it were just that, it's called iatrogenics, and iatrogenics is medically induced through errors. The third highest cause is iatrogenic injuries. Right. Just to give an example of, you know, why even the reference to medicine would be not necessarily an ultimate variable that we would all agree upon. Truth of the matter, the only thing that we all can agree upon is that life is a passage from birth to death, and that alongside that passage, we then determine another understanding whether I look at my body as a biological organism that has some form of dignity and that is somehow exposed to the experiences that we happen to go through, or whether I surrender my body to a materialistic dissection of, looking at body parts. And in this, nowadays, at our genetic makeup as something that can be manufactured and manipulated. Again, whether or not one opts for one side or the other side is a choice. And so with which authority will we have then to say, well, if you are not opting for the other side, then you're doing something wrong and you are lesser of a human. So it's, you know, searching for this external reference point that gives certainty to all of us that no, we must go for the DNA approach to health rather than the, you know, herbalist approach. Truth of the matter, sooner or later, we all face the same fate, right? And that's the grand situation that we are all aware of. at the same time, with which rhetoric could you convince the herbalist that the DNA approach is the more desirable? You know, to search for the absolute validation of one's viewpoint, that is the problem. We all have preferences, right? So anyone, or as you observe now in, you know, in American politics, I don't know, I hear it's similar in Europe also, that even having an uttering and disagreement in the context of a conversation could be considered as a threat in the political arena, right? And so we are stifling dialogue in a way that appears to some interpretation as a very authoritarian regulation of public speech, right? Something that is kind of, you know, amazing. How is that possible in the United States of America, right? Mm-hmm. You would expect that kind of behavior in different political formations.
I think Jaspers will give two answers. He would say, we have reason, Vernunft, to discuss this, and we should communicate. This would be his two answers. Mm-hmm. And maybe the third answer, that is that there is not a final answer I can give you. You have to find it by yourself, by thinking and communicating.
The answer to that is, and we need a lot of reason and Vernunft in order to build a nuclear bomb. And we need a lot of reason and Vernunft in order to develop artificial intelligence warfare technologies that if you do some research about it, you don't want to have anything to do with it. So reason and Vernunft is very important to advance humankind. Reason and Vernunft is also the variable that allows us to develop narratives that consider the shift from human intelligence to artificial intelligence as the next step in an evolutionary development. Reason and Vernunft in and by itself is, as we know from the history of philosophy, whether reason and Vernunft is the commander in chief or simply the way of justifying our instinct and emotions depends, right?
Taking these annotations, Helmut, perhaps we can, at the end of the session, go back to Jaspers, and where we also see, and when we take a look at the development of Jaspers' thinking, that also there, reason and Vernunft has been more important and more important to the end of his life. So he started his philosophical journey, let's say, with the Psychologie der Weltanschauung, and he ended with quite a lot of different concepts. And Mr. Ola has pointed out in his lecture that the term of worldview don't play any role anymore after the Psychologie der Weltanschauung. There's a when we take a look in the philosophical logic, for example, there's in these over 1,000 pages, there are only 1.5 pages or something like this dedicated to the concept of worldview, and this only in a way to make clear that there is a problematic approach of doing such systematic things of finding or defining worldviews. We have also heard in Mr. Papa's speech something about the current threats of humankind and about global warming and these political dimensions of, and also Helmut, you have mentioned this, making a political statement nowadays is quite often more dangerous than one could think in our current world, where we all have make through the process of enlightenment, and we have very highly developed technology everywhere. And there, I think we can also take a look at that. There are differences in reason. There are also different kinds of reasons. There might be a kind of technological reason, and there is another type of reason, and a reason type of reason which is more important for Jaspers, or when Jaspers talks about reason. And I think it's always important to ask oneself the question, why is it worth to still read Jaspers? and nowadays. If I may, Mr. Rindermann, perhaps one of the questions you have quite emphatically at the end of your speech talked about the benefits of reading still Jaspers. But my question would be, do you still recommend, for example, at your students, or the same question would be to all of you who are teaching at the university, do you still recommend reading Jaspers, and for what reason?
I would recommend most read Psychology of Worldviews. It's a book about enthusiasm for young people. And second, it's an introduction in philosophies. And the other second book of Jaspers that I would recommend is Geistige Situation der Zeit, because this is a very critical examination of political ideologies and also very critical with psychoanalysis. These two books I would recommend most to read.
It is very rare that we can say about a philosopher that he has triggered a revolution. And Jaspers did so. In Italy in the 60s, there was a major revolution in the field of psychiatry. And by what the protagonists said, Franco Basaglia, it was Jaspers who inspired him to this movement. Second, how many philosophers have been dedicated, admittedly, a critical article in Nature? It was 2 years ago on the thesis that there is an axial age and so on. There is a major research project going on, funded by I don't know how many American universities, trying to falsify Jaspers' claim. So if it comes to effective history, I would say Jaspers is one of the major figures of the 20th century, and he will be so also in 150 years, I would bet. And third, nowadays, there is this type of intellectual, like Jaspers was, and inspiring, very much inspiring Hannah Arendt, for example, this kind of public intellectuals, but not in the French, sorry about being such a chauvinist, not in the French sense of the word, a very critical public intellectual. In the Anglo-Saxon world, it's completely unknown to me, because Noam Chomsky is another type of figure and coming from another tradition, from American structuralism. So I would say I would very much recommend to take issue with Jaspers, but especially, as I tried to stress in my talk, in this specific moment in German history, this turning point, this clash between neo-Kantianism and neo-Hegelianism, and he represented a very clever position from my point of view. The ending section of Psychology of Worldviews is an essay on Kant, and this in a time where neo-Kantianism was almost dying. Yeah? 1919, there was also another very important book, Religion of Reason, out of the Jewish sources by Hermann Cohen. He died 1 year before, and his wife, Martha Cohen Lewandowski, died in Auschwitz, 1942. In these years of really destruction and tragedy, a huge tradition has been destructed, maybe forever, yeah? He embodies a very clever and very brave, also you don't have to forget what, because he lived in Germany, yeah? Very brave and intellectually very clever position. So for this reason, he is an example, not only for philosophers, I would say.
It's not to underestimate his meaning directly after the war for the reconstruction also of an intellectual Germany.
He's a role model, because before National Socialism came into power, he has criticized fascism, and he was as an independent thinker, not being influenced by National Socialism. This is a really good positive role model.
There's one problem though with it. He happens to be male and white. For anybody who is teaching at the university in America, you know that the curriculum is actively through administrative directives changed, that anything that goes into that direction is being shunned as a form of imperialistic thinking. So I'm talking about the cultural component of it. I'm not talking about the science, right? The STEM research is, you know, that seems to be immune. It doesn't matter where you're coming from and what you're doing as long as you succeed.
Well, Jasper said that struggle is a Grenzsituation, is a limit situation. So you have to fight. Hmm? The life is also struggling and fighting. You cannot avoid it.
And I don't know if it's a similar phenomenon also in European universities or not yet.
Absolutely so, yeah.
The same also.